Good evening. My name is Sue Moran. I'm with the Department of Health and Human Services, and it's my privilege to open tonight's community meeting. As you'll note from the agenda, we have many partners that are part of this meeting tonight. Our goal tonight here is to provide you with updated information, to answer your questions, and hopefully leave you with the information you need to make decisions about yourself, about your family, and your community as it relates to the PFC contamination here that we'll be discussing this evening. So again, on behalf of the department and all of us here, I'm very pleased to be here. I'm going to ask Sue Manenti to come up and join me. Sue is from the Department of Health and Human Services. She's going to walk us through the agenda and help point out to you the partners that are with us here today, so you'll have an understanding of who the speakers are, again, the agencies that they represent.
All right, so let's get rolling. Our first presentation tonight is Chris Bush with the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services.
Okay, next slide, please, Corey. All right, this follows a little bit of what is in the agenda for tonight. We're going to be talking about how we got to this point today, where this all began as far as the drinking water issue in town. I'm going to talk a little bit about PFCs, perfluorinated chemicals, and the public health issues that we have with that. I'm going to talk about the EPA's health advisory levels, and there's new news on that if you are not aware of it. I'm going to take a break from talking, and Bob Delaney is going to talk about where the data are at for the investigation or investigations that have been going on. More about the MDEQ data, but he will probably be mentioning some of the data that the Air Force has been collecting as well. Sometimes it's been side-by-side sampling that has been done. Then the talk is going to come back to me, and I'm going to talk about how we worked through the data evaluation and how we continue to work through it. I'm going to talk about the decision tree, and that was one of the handouts on the table up here. It shows a diagram, pretty much a flow chart of how these decisions are being made. At that point, I'm going to turn it over to District Health Department 2 so that Denise Bryan can talk a little bit about the process they are working through for alternate water or a reverse osmosis system. And we also, I believe that the person from the Culligan place is here tonight to talk a little bit about specifics of what this Culligan system does and give you more information about that. The Air Force will briefly give an activity update, and then we will have some words from Senator Stamos as far as legislative activities that are ongoing as well. Next slide, please. So timeline. I shared this timeline when I was here back in March, but not everybody here tonight was here back in March. So just to review it, in September of last year, a water supply well for a mobile home park in the area was identified from a database, and therefore the state and Air Force determined, well, it needs to be sampled because it's near the Air Force base. We know there's contamination at the base. Could it be coming off the base? So the sampling occurred, and in October we received results, and it said yes, there are PFCs from the base in this well at the mobile home park. Thus, the Air Force put together a plan under direction from the DEQ to put together a sampling work plan so that they would go systematically to areas we felt were most likely to be impacted by the contamination coming off the base. And they began that sampling in December. The Air Force and MDEQ sampled side by side at about a couple of dozen private residential wells. You know, I think you're well aware, and some of you probably are, that the snowbirds and not here all the time. And so it was difficult to get every single well sampled in December. So good start with the 24. Results came back in January, and we realized, well, we need to do some outreach. So MDHHS started preparing a fact sheet to help understand the well results, and then people started receiving letters. They received the results that the Air Force's lab reported. They received the results that the MDEQ lab reported. Then they received a letter from State Health Department saying, you know, this is what we understand, this is what we're recommending, and we're having a meeting in March to talk about that. And then there was also outreach by the local health department. So a lot of letters came in the mail. March, we had the public meeting, and also that month I was able to finish up the final report that shows our evaluation process. And again, I'm going to go through that a little later, probably after Bob shares the data where they're at right now. So next slide, please. So here, laser pointer, please. Thanks. So here I am, this hash marked area, this is a map that was put together by the Air Force's consultant showing the area that they were focusing on for the well survey plan. And as we'll learn tonight, there are additional areas that have been sampled since that we're getting information on and determining what, if any, kind of recommendations are going to be made for the area. Next slide, please. So, a little bit about PFC's public health and the key points that I would like you to bring home tonight. Number one is the health department with the state, also with the local health department partnering together. We are taking a conservative stance, and by that we mean protective. So we want to be sure that we would rather be overprotective rather than not enough. So there are things that we do know and there are things that we don't know. We don't know all there is to know about the PFCs that are present in the groundwater. There are a lot of PFCs out there, different ones, different names to them. So we do know a lot of information about a couple of those specific PFCs. Those are the ones that EPA has set health advisory levels for in the drinking water. But there are others that we know are present, sometimes at higher concentrations, that we are not sure what they mean, so we want to be protective. So we are using the best available science. We are using a decision tree. So if you are asking, well, how did you come to that decision? We hope that the tree that we're showing you, the diagram, which I'll talk through in just a few minutes after Bob's presentation, will help show the steps that we took to make the conclusions that we did about that particular sample. Now, just because we come up with some answers today doesn't mean that that's the end of the story. We are requesting more data. We want to verify the results. We want to strengthen our conclusions because we want to make sure we have this right. We want to make sure that you're protected and that the things that are needed to be done do get done. Next slide, please. So perfluorinated compounds have common uses that a lot of us have probably heard of. Teflon, they're used in non-stick applications. And a lot of these are non-stick applications. This is water-repellent fabric for Gore-Tex. Stainmaster is carpeting. Scotchgard is in a spray can. There are other uses for these chemicals. But I wanted to share with you some of the more common terms that you probably have heard of. The way PFCs were used at the Air Force was that they, or at the Air Force Base, was that they were an ingredient in the specialized firefighting foam that's used. This is a foam that is very good at putting out hard to put out fires. So it's called aqueous film forming foam, or you'll hear us often say AFFF. This carbon fluorine chemical bonds that make up PFCs that are kind of the backbone makes that backbone very rigid. It will not break apart. It does not break down in the environment at all easily and sometimes not at all. So that's why I mean, they do not break down, and they tend to build up in the environment. And they can build up in people, too. Next slide, please. Now let's talk a little bit about the EPA health advisory level. When I was here in March, I talked about provisional health advisory levels that EPA had out. Now, these are levels in drinking water that are not regulated. So that there's really not a rule that says you have to meet this number. However, if that number is exceeded, if a sample that's taken is higher than that EPA number, there are certain steps that EPA recommends that a water supplier would need to take. So back when it was provisional, and at that time it was being used for short-term exposure, somewhere on the order of a month, that they said that for this particular PFC, PFOA, or PFOA, as we pronounce it, that provisional value was 400 part per trillion, or PPT. That is, for those of you who have received results from the lab that the DEQ uses, that lab reports it in nanograms per liter. So that is the same as part per trillion. For PFAS, the provisional advisory level was 200. Well, less than a month ago, EPA came out with what are called the lifetime health advisory levels. And this is no longer short term. It's meant for life. And they determine, based on similar actions and a similar critical effect between these two compounds, that you could add them together and not exceed 70. So that means you could have 70 of PFOA and nothing of PFAS. You could have the other way around, or some mixture. If you don't exceed 70, then you don't exceed the health advisory level. This is meant to be protective of short-term and long-term exposure. Usually when we talk about short-term exposure, we think that it's okay to be exposed to something a little higher because you're not exposed to it as long, so your body can start recovering sooner if there's anything that happens. However, with short-term exposure, there is a concern that we want to protect a fetus. For a pregnant female, there could be a very short one-day exposure that we may not know enough about that chemical, and we would be concerned that it could cause some kind of harm, some kind of change to the fetus that could affect it throughout its life. So this short term is meant to be protective of the fetus. The long term is meant to be protective of anything that's not a fetus or a newborn. And it's protecting against cancer and non-cancer effects. Next slide, please. I'm going to turn the slide presentation over to MDEQ, to Bob Delaney, for him to continue on, and then I will come back after he talks about the data.
Hey, does that, can you hear me? It sounds like it.
A little higher.
A little higher? Okay.
There you go.
All right, thank you. Okay, so yes, I'm the project manager for the state on this site. I work with the Defense Department on overseeing the cleanup with this site and other sites across the state, and it's part of what's known as the Defense and State Memorandum of Agreement grant program, so that actually the military pays my salary to help them meet state law. So that we've been working together on this site for 20-some years now, and this new contaminant that we're looking at was a surprise to all of us. We thought we'd been making really great progress on getting this place cleaned up, and this has kind of set us back, and you're all here because of that. I'm a geologist by training, so I get excited about some of these things that'll bore you, but I'm going to cover some of it anyway, because it'll help you as you hear the what's going on and understanding if you've got a well, how it got impacted. Okay, next slide. All right, so Chris touched a little bit on what PFCs are in, and they are in literally thousands of products. There are actually 3,000 of these chemicals in commerce right now, so we're talking about a small subset that's in firefighting foams. So the stuff that you're dealing with here in this city, in this township, that's a unique set of chemicals that are quite common, but there are other PFCs out there that are also have similar characteristics, but they weren't in this particular product. So anyway, some of the things that it's used in, like semiconductors, your computers, you're all familiar with Teflon and the nonstick coatings. And when you think about these chemicals, you think about, well, they put it in your pan so the stuff wouldn't stick to it. What is that? A pan is getting heated really fast and hard. The Teflon keeps the foods from sticking to it. The Teflon, it breaks down over time, but that's really the matrix. It's not the actual Teflon that's breaking down. It just stays the same for through that. And that's why one of the reasons they use it, it can handle that heat and things like that. So data, cable, and wiring, those heat up. They use PFCs in them because they don't break down. Your car has lots of PFCs in it, and your gaskets and other things. Electronics, all kinds of piping. Any of you guys that do plumbing, you're wrapping stuff with Teflon tape. That's the stuff. Then aerospace, it's used a lot in aerospace because the chemicals, they don't change. You get, how some chemicals, especially the guys that work with stuff, get it hot, it swells or it shrinks. You get it cold, it does all those kind of things. Not PFCs, they stay the same. They don't break down. You can put them in acids, you can do about anything with them. They are pretty much indestructible. So they had great uses. I mean, we in a modern society depend on these chemicals. Next slide. So in the hospital, you're going to be running into them. Your paints, any kind of coverings, the carpet in here, it'll be in a lot of those things. I love my Gore-Tex. All my hunting gear is Gore-Tex. So we're familiar with this stuff in those forms. And then firefighting, of course, is what brings us here. Next slide. All right, so you've heard some of this, but here at Wurtsmith, and I am going to duplicate some of the stuff that I've told you before because there's new people in the crowd. But anyway, the primary source here at Wurtsmith for PFCs is the AFFF firefighting foam. And there are other things on the base. The hydraulic fluids in the airplanes would have had PFCs in them. So there are other things, soaps, waxes. It's in all those things. And, of course, the military would have used a lot of those. We, in our homes, use a lot of these. So prior to the invention of this firefighting foam, they used to use what were known as protein foams, and that was used up until about 1970. And Chris has already explained the fluorine-carbon bond, but I'm a geologist and always hated chemistry, but I found this fascinating and why this stuff is so indestructible. Nature, it's not made in nature. It takes a lot of energy to force that fluorine and carbon to get together, so you don't find it just around nature. Most stuff that we deal with, you can find it somewhere in nature, but not these chemicals. So anytime we find it, we know it's man-made. Again, PFCs are very resistant to breakdown. If you spill some gasoline on the ground, if you don't put too much there, the microbes and other stuff will break it down. Nothing breaks it down that we really know of in normal situations. Okay, next slide. So why do they use AFFF? And this is the reason why. In 1967, they had this crash on this aircraft carrier. And you can see it killed 134 sailors and Then there was 161 that were injured. Over $500 million worth of equipment was destroyed. They were trying to put it out with those protein foams I told you about. The military recognized this was, Navy recognized this was totally unacceptable, and I understand that they went to 3M and they said, we need something that works better. So 3M went to work and they came up with these firefighting foams and AFFF. So anyway, this is an example of what that AFFF does. Here was a fire, jet crashes, fuel tanks rupture, you've got a big fire going. And because of this foam, they saved 196 lives out of the 200 people on there. Now, this is something that I found amazing. I just learned it this year. But the rule on fighting a fire on a plane like this is that you've got 3 minutes, because the shell on that plane is going to burn through in 3 minutes. So the firefighters have to get to that fire. They have to put it out in 3 minutes. They figure 2 minutes to get to the plane, 1 minute to put out an oil fire or kerosene fire that is, you know, going to kill everybody in that plane if it breaches that shell. So like I say to everybody, if I'm in that plane, I hope they're using AFFF. And as much as I know about it, and as much as the trouble is it's causing us, I understand why it's there and why the military used it so extensively. Next slide. All right, so turning to the base. Here's Wurtsmith Air Force Base. This, just, you know, you, most of you are local here, but that's about 2 miles long right there to give you a sense of scale. Here is Van Etten Lake on this side of the base. Down here is the Asabo River. Obviously, Lake Huron's over here. This is Van Etten Creek. So we're going to talk about all these places. And then this is Clark's Marsh, kind of the first place where we recognized there was a big problem, because there was a firefighting station or training pad out there. And so this pond received a lot of high-level contamination, got into the fish, and another one of those unfortunate things happened in that these are the most contaminated fish that we've seen anywhere in the literature. So one of the reasons is they got trapped. You know, if you've been out there, there's dams there, so the fish are trapped in these places, so they continue to always get an exposure. So they became very contaminated. That's what started the whole do not eat the fish advisory stuff, and then we found that on the Asabo River that the local fish, the fish that stayed put, some of them were also heavily contaminated. So let's see. I think... So this is Van Etten Creek, and many of you live along in this area. And then, anyway, I guess we can go to the next slide. All right, so first of all, we're going to just talk a little bit about where they lost these PFCs, these firefighting foams. And some of the places were pretty obvious, and they jumped out. Well, they jumped out when we got some data, but here was a fire, here was a crash in, what was it, 1985? It is still highly contaminated out there. This is the base ops apron, and the fire department was somewhere right around here, and they used to test their equipment right here off this, so we knew this was going to be a bad area. Hangars, they all had systems to put out fires. You know, if a fire started in the hangar, they just doused the whole place with firefighting foam, and then the standard operating procedures go in there with fire hoses and hose it all out onto the grass. And that happened everywhere. This was not unique to Wurtsmith. There's the fire training area. Obviously, that's the... And in the military understood they had a problem at fire training areas, but they didn't... None of us really realized there was going to be a bigger problem than that. And then the wastewater treatment plant that received stormwater and some of the stuff that got flushed down, you know, into the sewers and things ended up at the wastewater treatment plant. So those were areas we kind of expected problems. Go ahead in the next slide. So so we went out initially and started just sampling randomly across the base. And because the Air Force had like 400 wells for the other previous contamination, so they routinely go out and sample. So we went along with them, and then we would take some samples of water and test it for the firefighting foams. It turned out that every well we sampled had the firefighting foams. I mean, that was a real revelation to us and to the military. So we sampled all the way across the base, just sort of randomly. And the Air Force then followed up. They did some more sampling, confirmed what we were seeing. And then now there's this program across the entire Air Force to go out to all the air bases, old and new, and figure out where these firefighting foams were used and lost and put into the environment. So as part of that program, the Air Force contracted with a company, AMEC, to go out and go through all the historical records, talk to people, try and find out wherever these PFCs might have been used. And so this was the areas that they found. You remember that little diagram that I showed you of sites? Well, this is all the areas that they found in historical records where the stuff might have been used, might have been lost to the environment. So they just completed going out to all these locations, putting in wells, sampling the soils to see what's there now. And we're just now getting the data in. So a lot of the things I'm going to show you today are going to change probably dramatically as we get more data to fill in the holes. Next slide. Okay, I wanted to give you, this is Environmental Geology 101, and this is the part I start really liking. I sometimes regret that I didn't go into looking for oil, because people are much happier with you when you find oil rather than this stuff. But anyway, you have a loss of your contamination, and this little blue line here is where your groundwater is. So, you know, if you dig down, you'll hit groundwater. So they, for whatever reason, they spill some AFFF on the ground here, and it goes down and it gets into the water and in the groundwater. And in this case, the groundwater is flowing from my left, your left to right, so it's flowing from this source area over to this lake. And as you see, this is what we, you know, typically call a plume, and it's flowing over here into a lake. And there are situations where it can flow under a lake, and that will be important when we talk a little bit later about the data from the space. But for the moment here, we're just showing it in a real simple, it'd be nice if everything was this simple, but it's not. And actually, when I got into this business back in the 70s, this was how complicated the diagrams looked like. They looked simple. You'd think it was easy to do this, but it turns out it's a lot more complex. But this is kind of the basics of it. So anyway, it flows here, and what we're showing here is it's intercepted by a stream. The groundwater will feed this stream, so the stream becomes contaminated. And when you think of three-pipe drain or Van Etten Creek or any of these others, that's how they get contaminated. Then Van Etten Lake, that we're showing the plume, is discharging into a lake. Last thing on this I wanted you to see is how, you know, you got your well results and your neighbor's got, you know, nothing in their well, and you've got a whole bunch in yours, or the other way around, or the health department saying you should get treatment, get off that water, even though your results look really, really good. Well, what we're finding here, and which is true anywhere, is that these plumes, they don't fill up the whole aquifer. They go in these little streams, for lack of a better word, but they're narrow, they can be very narrow, or they can be very wide. So in this case, we're showing somebody whose well happens to be in the plume, they're getting a big dose of this stuff, and then their next door neighbor, they're a little deeper in the aquifer, and same aquifer, but they're just not drawing in any of the pollution. And so if you compare your results to your neighbors, you're going to see these variations in what your results are and their results are. And then the other thing is you can go back at different times of the year and you'll find out that, oh, my levels have gone up or my levels have gone down. So just because you get a result back that seems low, it doesn't mean it's always going to be low or always was low. So that's why they give you the advice to not drink the water. Okay, next slide. So we talked about how, you know, you drop this contamination on the ground and it ends up in the lakes and the rivers. Well, this here is what's called a water table map. And the water underneath the ground, if you were to peel away the ground, it would be like it's on a hill just flowing down that surface. And I don't know, we'll get you lost on this probably. But anyway, what we can do is we can see how high is the groundwater from So up here, the groundwater is higher. It's maybe 2 foot higher than, say, over here. So what that means is if this water is 2 foot higher in the ground than this water, it's going to flow towards that location. So the low spots are going to be like the lake, the river, this creek over here, these ponds and marshes. So what you see is the water underground. You know, it rains, it snows up here, and then underground it starts flowing towards the nearest low spot, basically. And so that's what you see. So if you drop some contamination, you're over here, and you're wondering, how did I get contaminated in my well? Well, something happened up in here, let's say, and it just starts, the groundwater just takes it over to your place. That's how it happens, and it's quite simple. This is simple, but what happened here at Wordsmith isn't so simple. Next slide. Okay, now this is the plumes as we knew them, say, a month ago. This was based on the previous work where I told you we went out and then the Air Force went out and we sampled and they, you know, we confirmed each other's results and we also you know, just went into new areas and checked. All these question marks are areas that we didn't sample. There weren't any wells in the location. The Air Force wasn't going out and sampling. But if you remember that map that showed all those areas that might have contamination that the Air Force went out and looked at, well, those were in these areas, areas where we didn't know what happened. There was no wells. Nothing else had gotten lost there. So this will all be filling in and changing. And these, all this will get more refined as we get more data. And so it'll start to make more sense. But the other thing that I wanted to point out with this slide is that we're talking about PFOS and PFOA. Where PFOS is essentially the Scotch Guard. When you think of PFOS, you can think of Scotch Guard. And PFOS was in lots of things, but Scotch Guard is where, you know, it was well known for. And then Teflon is your PFOA. So we're just talking about those two. We have health advisory numbers for those two. But the thing to realize is that we've, out here, these firefighting foams have, we've measured 20 different PFCs in them. So we have risk numbers for PFOA and PFOS, but we don't have numbers for that other 18 chemicals that are out here that we know of. I mean, we just don't know what, there may be other chemicals, but we know of 18 more. We don't have cleanup standards. So when your health department's telling you, well, you know, we're concerned about what you might get exposed to beyond PFOS and PFOA, that's what they're talking about. These plumes have a lot of material in them of different types of chemicals. They have PFOS and PFOA, but they also have some of these other ones, and sometimes those other ones are much more of it in the well than your PFOS and PFOA. So I just wanted to show this slide to remind you that what I'm going to show you next is not the full story. We're going to talk about the risk number and where all that is, but first right now I wanted you to understand the big plumes. All right, next slide. Okay, so here's what I was talking about. These are the areas right now that we know about that have PFOS and PFOA above the 70 parts per trillion that Chris just talked about. She talked about 70 parts per trillion, and that's the, you know, protective number lifetime. Well, these areas that are in orange are the areas that we have found PFOA and PFOS higher than the 70. And the yellow doesn't mean that that's, you're in the clear there. That just means that the other, there's other chemicals that are maybe more concentrated than those two. Now, I wanted to get to the point to where we talked last time I was here. We were talking about contamination in other locations, and people wanted us to sample their wells, which is totally understandable. Even though I and my consultants didn't see a likelihood that the base could have contaminated various areas, we still went out at the direction of my management and in conjunction with talking to the health department, we went out and sampled some areas to give us all, you know, sort of a peace of mind that, hey, it is as we thought it was. Well, in some places it was as the way we thought it was, but there's a couple places it wasn't. And so anyway, people asked us to sample up here north of the base at a road called Coal Bath, and there's a subdivision in there, and I think it's about 100 homes, isn't that, what you said, Dale? Okay, so there's about 100 homes in there. We went in and we sampled one well. And the thought was, what the people were thinking, I think, at the time, was that the contamination on the north end of the base had somehow made its way up there. Well, there was geologic reasons why we didn't think that was possible, but we went out and sampled anyway. Turns out that they did have AFFF in their wells. So that was a surprise to me, but I'm glad we went out there. And so since then, we've gone out and sampled, I think, 7 more wells in that area, and we're probably not done sampling in that area. Still, we don't know any connection to the base. I did talk to the neighbors. There was a house that burnt down up there, and we don't know if they used AFFF at that to put out that fire. But we haven't got an explanation for that situation at this time, and we will be pursuing it to find out what caused this problem and how big of a problem is it. The other surprise was this one right here. People on Loud Drive asked us to go out and get some samples from their side of the lake. So we said, okay, we'll go grab, because there, you know, I showed you in that little geology thing that plumes can underflow a lake, all right? So in certain situations, a plume can get under a lake onto the other side, and I have to, hats off to my division chief, he was saying, well, we've seen it where it does that. So we went out and we sampled on the other side. And I will show that where we sampled a little bit later, but we did find an AFFF hit on this side with PCE, which is a degreaser. You know, if you degrease your car engine, you'll know about those kinds of things. But there was the degreaser and the firefighting foam in this well. Now, there's two explanations. One, it's coming from that side of the lake. Somehow, somebody used that stuff over there and it got in people's wells. There's no clear, obvious thing. There's not like a dry cleaner. There's not like there's nothing over industrial, nothing like that. There's nothing obvious that would cause it. So the other explanation is that it got under the lake. And as I talked with my hydrogeologist, that we've talked before that there's that dam there, and that dam causes the lake level to go up and down dramatically from spring to fall. And so it could be that during certain times of the year, the groundwater just flows under the lake because the lake is so high it can't flow into the lake, or something like that. We've got to still do the, try and understand how it got there. We have gone out. We've sampled more wells right around that one. We've sampled wells up here as well to try and understand what's going on. The wells we sampled up here I'll talk about later, but those all looked normal, like what you would expect on the other side of the lake. No firefighting foams in those. Then down here, of course, is the school. We knew that there had been 2 fires down here, both put out with foam. So we sampled the neighborhood. We now know that there's a plume, maybe 2 plumes of contamination, AFFF firefighting foams. Again, that's an area we're going to have to continue to do more sampling. We've done, 10 wells out there? Yeah, 10 out there. So we're trying to fill in these gaps. And then for those of you on Oak Drive or Oak Street on the other side of the lake, we've sampled your wells, and we told you we were going to be doing that at the last meeting. And those also are contaminated. They look very similar to the contamination on the other side of the dam. So we're thinking it's the same cause, probably coming from the lake itself. The lake has PFCs. Often the lake water will go around a dam like that in the ground, and so they're probably picking up some PFCs from that. Anyway, I think we'll go ahead and move on now. Okay, so the Air Force has talked before, and I guess we have too, about the wells, the existing system that was put in place to deal with the kerosene or the jet fuel. And it was put in there to deal with the chlorinated solvents, the degreasers. Anyway, so there's 5 pump and treat systems. What that is you put in a well and you just suck the water out of the ground and you try and capture all the contaminated water that you can. And these systems had been put in here, as I said, to deal with these especially to deal with the jet fuel and the chlorinated solvents. And they have protected a lot of the people down here. As you, if you remember that plume, those plumes I showed with the black here, black meant really bad. All right. Well, that really bad stuff got stopped at these, at this well field. But on the other hand, you can see there's areas where the well field hasn't controlled it completely. And recently we found a well that's very, very contaminated somewhere up in here, one of the residential wells. Air Force has already moved out to replace their water, but it's way above. If you're here and you have results, your results are very, very low compared to what is in that well. That well's really got a lot in it. So as the health department's tried, as said, you know, we just don't know where these plumes are, how hot they are, if they could get into your well in the future, even if they're not there today. I'm going to grab my pop. Next slide. So I said this is a map of the wells that we have sampled. And so you can see it's scattered around. I mean, we focused, obviously, in the areas that where the drinking water advisory is. And that was the first area of concern after we discovered there was contamination in the wells. Then, since then, I mentioned we've sampled along Loud Drive. There's a couple more, three more in here that we've sampled, but we haven't got the results. If it's in blue, we've got the results back. If it's in orange, we're still waiting for the results. And we'll be continuing to sample out here as we go along in areas of concern. But right now, they've also sampled a bunch of new wells up in here that's not showing on this map. But I'll go on and I'll show you some more things on this map. These are background wells. They're impacted only by groundwater that has fallen up in the forest and moved down gradient into these wells. So we sampled those because we want to understand one of the things that maybe, I don't know if I mentioned at the last meeting, but these contaminants are distributed around the globe. And they're the highest if you they sampled polar bear fat, for instance, in northern Canada and in Greenland. And they found that these PFCs were the highest level of man-made contamination in the polar bear. So, you know, it's obviously, you know, they're not wearing Gore-Tex up there or doing anything like that. The polar bears are just out eating seals and stuff. And yet they're picking up these contaminants. So they're all over the globe. They're in every population, human population that has been sampled. They're just everywhere. It's not me, is it? Doesn't sound like the thing I have. All right. So what I expect, and I told this to management, that if we go out and sample people's residential wells, we will find PFCs in their wells. Not because the Air Force did any firefighting in the area, not because of any particular thing. It's just that these things are around the globe, and they come down in the air. You're using them in your house. They're flushing into your septic field. So they're just everywhere. And so like I was saying, like up here at Colbath, it doesn't really surprise me we ran into something. It may have nothing to do with the Air Force, but there somebody could have put out a fire up there. I don't know. So anyway, one of the questions was, if you come here and you ask me, hey, I'd like to have my well sampled, and we say, well, I know I'm going to find PFCs in your well. How do we know that it's not associated with the base, or how do we know that it's not a bigger problem? So one of the things we did is we looked at these background wells. All right, what am I going to find if I just go out in the forest and look at the water? And so we can now compare whatever's in your well with what you'd find in the forest water as well. And we're going to show you some pie charts that are pretty interesting to help you understand this. So anyway, that's the sampling we've done. The other thing I wanted to point out in this, and I'm sorry these don't stand out more, there are some little yellow triangles on here. And one of the things that struck us last meeting, before the meeting actually, but was that we had looked at the contamination in fire hydrants out at the base. Because what we knew was these never break down. If a fire fire hydrant had been flushed, like say in the 80s, and nobody had ever flushed it again, there could be water trapped in it. So we wanted to just see what the levels were back in those days, how much was in the system. So we were sampling those, and we'd gotten data from 20 or 30 of them. And it dawned on me that we never found a clean hydrant. So I'm sitting there thinking, well, if they flushed it recently, it should have been clean. It should have looked like Lake Huron water. But it didn't. So we said, so then the question was, well, does the system that people are drinking out of have PFCs from the old days? Not just what is from Lake Huron, but do they have some of that? So anyway, these are the places that we sampled for those PFCs. And I'm going to let the health department talk to you about, you know, what the results meant and mean. I will tip it off that there's a signature of the old firefighting foams in the system, but it's extremely low. And Chris will talk to you a little bit about what that means, or Denise. So I think that's it on this slide. Go ahead to the next one. So this is to show you the areas that we're still, you know, targeting for sampling. This should have extended up here all along this as well. We're trying to fill in everybody's got a well in that area we want to get sampled and give them advice. Then now we've extended over to this side of the lake. We're looking down here on the other side of Van Etten Creek. These two areas will have to be figured out also at some point. So that's kind of the areas of interest right now. Next slide. Okay, I talked about the background levels. And it's hard to see here, but the levels in the background wells are like below 5 parts, well, they're around 5. The maximum, I think, is close to 5, 4.42. All right, 5 parts per trillion total PFCs. If you look at the Lake Huron water, it's about 6 to 7 parts per trillion. So this is actually the water out in the forest is actually better than Lake Huron water. But Lake Huron water is remarkably good because you go anywhere else in the state, you're going to find it. It's in Lake Erie, it's in Lake Michigan, it's in Lake Huron, Ontario. Superior might be better. So anyway, this water, your water out here in the forest is really good. Next slide. So one of the things I said was, all right, how do I know when I'm looking at a well? I mean, some of you that have impacted wells might only have 5-6 parts per trillion of total PFCs in there. How do I know if it's this background stuff or is it the firefighting foams? Well, what we did is we took what we're finding in the firefighting foams in your wells. We're focused on PFOS and PFOA. We know that those often show up in the firefighting foams. PFHXS, this is the contaminant most often found on the base, actually. It's a part of the firefighting foam, it's a little bit different. So because that's so common, we put that on our pie chart. And then other PFCs, just any other one. There could be, there's a whole suite of them. Like I said, there's 20 total, so you can get any of those mixed in there. And then these C14 and C16 were the ones that we were seeing out in the forest. So when you see this showing up, you start thinking forest background. Okay, next slide. Okay, so here's those forest wells. And you can see they're made up of other, and they're made up of those C16, C14. So that's what you would, you know, if you just randomly put in a well out here somewhere, that's likely what you would see. So then we go to the north side of Loud Drive, and we see that same gray and blue. And then we go down here, and this is a house away from where the school plumes were. And again, you see that gray and that blue. But then when you get to the base, you start seeing a lot of red and a lot of green. Lots of red, lots of green. Again, over here, up here, you're seeing that same thing. Up here in Colbath, see, this is how I know Colbath looks to me like it's a firefighting foam. It's got the PFOS, the PFOA, and the perfluorohexane sulfonate. It's got the three components that I see all the time in firefighting foam. So there, we're pretty sure that's firefighting foam. You look down here at the schoolyard, firefighting foam again. And then over in this area, we've got a mix of the two. So the people in North Loud Drive, they only have 4 or 5 parts per trillion, but it looks like the forest. Same down here, 4 or 5 parts per trillion, looks like the forest. So that's how one of the ways we separate it out, to figure out if you got hit by the Air Force's AFFF or some other firefighting foam. Next slide. So again, that's why you don't see us really focusing much up in this area, because we're pretty confident that that looks like the forest. It looks like the background. It's not showing contamination. But then again, we are looking at these areas where it looks like the firefighting foams. Next slide. And that's it. Any? Is that a groan of relief or something?
We could take a few questions for Bob now.
Oh, okay.
Any questions for Bob right now?
Sure, I got one. Did any of these chemicals stick in your plumbing?
Well, that's one of the, you know, that's a good question, because we're looking at the big system on the base, and we're seeing just a little bit of these PFCs from the firefighting foams in the system. So the question is, how come it's still there? Because that, they've had not had any water from the ground and from the firefighting foams since 1997. So this is, 10 years later almost, and they're still showing a little bit of that firefighting foam in the system. So somehow it's staying in the system, but most of it's flushed out by now. But yeah, somehow it's some of it stays in the system a little bit.
On the east side of Lake Bennett, there's a couple of creeks coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Now, does that assist the flushing, perhaps, of the chemicals?
Well,
On the east side of Lake Bennett.
I can go ahead and.
Okay.
All right.
On the east side of Lake Bennett, there's two creeks primarily that come into Lake Bennett. And mm-hmm. I'm curious, does the water from those creeks perhaps help flush out some of the chemicals?
Right. The question is, on the east side of Van Atten Lake, there are two creeks that come into the lake. And the question is, do those creeks help flush the contamination out of the lake? And really, you could ask if it helps with the ground, too, because those creeks are being fed by the groundwater. So if the creeks intercepted some groundwater that had PFCs, yes, they would be taking that out of the system. Or they would just be displacing it into Van Atten Lake that then goes to Lake Huron. Then, and then also the lake keeps flushing. If the lake didn't, I showed you the Clark's Marsh where the fish are extremely contaminated. Well, those are dammed up ponds. The fish are stuck in there, the water moves out slowly, so you see very high levels. Whereas in Van Atten Lake, you see pretty low levels. It's because there's so much water flushing through there, it dilutes it all out. Good questions.
One more question for Bob.
Oh, I don't know if you realize this. Can they look for these chemicals in your blood, in your system, in your body?
Well, the question was, can you look for these chemicals in your blood, in your body? And the answer to that is yes, but I'd like you to talk to Chris, when she gets back up here, and ask her about that kind of sampling. Okay?
We will have time after all of the presentations for you to ask more questions of each presenter. Now we'll go back to Chris.
All right. So, can you back up a slide, Sue? I think that this is too far ahead. Well, no, it isn't too far. There. Okay. So, we talked about, before I turned it over to Bob to talk about the data, I mentioned the EPA health advisory numbers, which looks at PFOA and PFOS together in these wells, and I'm also showing what was in the municipal water from Hushra. So, this is more data than we had last time, so there's a lot more lines on this. All these numbers mean are numbers that I assign to the properties so that they are not individually identified for the private residences. So Hushra is at the top to show you generally what the situation is, and you don't really see a red mark there for PFOS. It does have PFOA in it. And when I arranged this graph, it goes from that first one after Hushra down to the bottom. It goes from the lowest total PFCs to the highest total PFCs found in the wells. So this order here is going to be the same in the next slide when we get to it. But one thing I wanted to point out, Bob talked about the sampling at the high school that falls around there. The trailer park was further down here somewhere. And then the rest of these are the individual wells that have been sampled. Out here is our 70 part per trillion line. None of the wells on this chart have hit that line. Now, Bob did mention the one well that came back with very high concentrations. That is not on this chart. First off, it would be way out there somewhere, the line would be. And also, we have heard about the Air Force's data. I've heard a little bit about the DEQ data just getting in, but I want to look at that and make sure that we think that that is indeed a real detection. And then that would be something that comes on the chart then. But so this is just showing the PFOA, PFOA, and PFOS together. But as we've been discussing, is we are interested and concerned about the other PFCs that are in there. So when Sue advances to the next slide, you get a lot more color in here. And this purple bar out here on the right end of each of these lines is the PF hexane sulfonate. So perfluorohexane sulfonate is the whole name of the chemical. And that does tend to be a predominant amount of the mix, especially as it gets higher and higher in concentrations. And in this bottom line, it's not that purple area, it's the purple area out here. This computer program was a little bit limited for the number of colors to show. So you've got some things that are looking to the same, and what Bob was showing in his pie charts were percents. This does not show percent. If it were percent, the lines would be all the way out here, and this number would be 100, and then we can compare it like that. But I kind of like the pie charts that Bob showed in his slide to give you a good comparison for that. So we do have concerns, because in this last well that has the most PFCs in it, it's over 450 part per trillion. PFOA and PFOS do not exceed 70. But when we did the data evaluation, we were not putting this into a numbers issue. Sue, next slide, please.
Could you just show us where 70 is, Chris?
Okay, I'm sorry. So 70 part per trillion is just going to be to the left of midway between these lines here. Right now, we cannot take the total PFC count and count it against 70. Right now, it's just that previous slide that showed PFOA and PFOS together to compare against 70. But if you'll shift to the next slide, I want to talk a little bit about the data evaluation. I talked about this last March. It's also in my evaluation report, which is available on our website, and the slide handouts, the last slide, I'll talk about how to get to that website. So the contamination at the base, we do not feel is fully understood or controlled at this point. There's those little fingers that are coming out. We don't know how deep they are, how things are flowing. We have historic data because of the historic contamination from the chlorinated solvents and the petroleum that was out there. But PFCs are new to this investigation and to the keeping up with cleanup at this base. And so we need to make sure that we have a good understanding. That's why Bob and I are talking about additional sampling, to have a good understanding of where it's going and who could be affected by it. So one other thing that we had to consider in our data evaluation, when you take a single sample of a well, that is not, it cannot determine what past exposure or amount or duration was in that well, and it's not going to be predictive of the future. Bob showed in what he called his conceptual model how the, and described it verbally too, about how the groundwater, the way it flows, could change. It could be up closer to the surface of the soil, or it could go deeper depending on whatever conditions are happening at that time. So we do understand that contamination at Wirt Smith Air Force Base is moving towards the drinking water wells. The pie charts help determine that, yes, that's contamination at the base. We're seeing it at the base, we're seeing it in the wells. PFCs in most of the water, well water samples are higher than in Hushra. There were some private well samples that came back with virtually no PFCs in them. Hushra was 6 part per trillion total. There were some that were maybe 2 or 3 part per trillion. And so you're thinking, great, but it's in that area where it's very close to the Air Force Base, and we do expect that it could be impacted. From a toxicology standpoint, there are animal studies, there are studies in humans, in communities where there have been drinking water contamination events by PFCs, where the human studies have occurred, or in workers who have worked in the plants where these chemicals are either manufactured or used. And so we have some understanding. It's not a comprehensive database, but the understanding that we do have, we feel there is a potential for harm with too much exposure to that. We understand that PFCs can be persistent, that they can bioaccumulate, meaning that they can build up in the animals that are out there, the fish. We had that situation. There have been studies on swallows that nest by the marsh. And we know that some PFCs have long half-lives in humans. For PFOA, it is considered that it's about a little over two and a quarter years, it would take whatever amount is in your body to reduce it by half. That's what a half-life is. For PFOS, that half-life, I believe, is somewhere on the order of 5.5 years about. For the perfluorohexane sulfonate, the HXS, the one that seems to be predominant in a lot of these samples showing a triple F signature, that half-life is about on the order of 8 to 10 years. They're still trying to determine what that is. There are some PFCs in these samples that probably have much shorter half-lives. But these three are ones that we have some understanding of. And so that is what we took into our minds while we were considering these data that we got back in December and that we're continuing to gather. Next slide, please. Okay. I'm going to point you to the decision tree flow chart that was one of the handouts up here. It has all the arrows over it. And I'm going to go down the left side of it first. And this is for wells that are down gradient. I think Sue's going to walk through. If anybody doesn't have them, just hold up your hand and she'll make sure she gets one to you. So the first area that we're looking at is this area down gradient or essentially downstream from a PFC groundwater plume that originates at the base? And once I work through this slide, I'm going to show you what I mean on the map. So let's say the answer is yes. It is downstream, down gradient from a plume that is at the Air Force Base. So based on our understanding of how these are moving, how the PFCs are moving in this conceptual model that Bob described, is the well within that area that we expect to be impacted? If we say yes, then we are not waiting for data now. We already have data. The data that were collected in December and that we talked about in March indicate that these wells in this area where we expected an impact are showing an impact. So then we would recommend seeking alternate water and the offering of a reverse osmosis system. I want to point out the asterisk here. You can choose to connect to township water if that's currently available. It's my understanding that there are some potential connections that can be made because the water main is really close to your home if you're one of the ones where we would make this recommendation. Now, there may be areas that wells have been sampled or we're considering sampling wells that right now, the way we understand the way this should have been moving would not be in the area. They are downstream from or down gradient from Wurtsmith and from the plumes there, but we wouldn't expect them to be impacted. So if data are available on that well, and it's showing that they're present, and that the ones that are present are from looking like the Air Force, the signature from the plume coming from the Air Force base, then we are going to recommend seeking alternate water or getting an RO system. So present. It's not talking about a health advisory level there. It's just a yes, no. If it's a no, or if there aren't data available, we need to have that data to make that decision. We just felt that this was the rationale we had to follow. So now I'm going to move over to the right side of that flow chart sheet. So next slide. Oh, I'm sorry. Before I move over to the right side of the sheet, I wanted to show you the areas that fit for the left side of the sheet. So this nice oblong box that encloses the investigation area that originally delineated by the Air Force work plan to sample the wells. Those are down gradient from plumes coming off of Wurtsmith, that multicolored page, slide that Bob showed you. And they've already indicated that we expect there to be an impact, and there are data that's showing that there have been impacts. So this would be an area where, without data, we would say, seek an alternate water supply, talk to the local health department about that, and the possibility of getting a reverse osmosis system. The other part of that was, it's down gradient from plumes coming from the Air Force base, but it's outside of this area where we expected it to be bounded by Dry Creek up here, by Venetian Creek over here. So we came around, we sampled down by the dam on the east side of Venetian Creek. And so that fits that down gradient, yes, does not fit the conceptual site model, but we do have data that are indicating that there are PFCs matching the signature from the Air Force base in these wells, and also in this well area that Bob described. So the data say yes. So for those homes that say the data say yes, it's there, then we are offering the reverse osmosis system, or at least recommending an alternate water source. Okay, now I'm going to move over to the right side of that flow chart diagram. So now we're talking about groundwater plumes other than the ones that are originating at the Air Force base. So this is, and you'll see it on the map, this is like Colbath, north end of the east side of Venetian on Loud, and down by the school. We do not anticipate these, we're still finding out more about them, we don't anticipate these being down gradient from the very large plumes that are at the base. So if we have data for the well, and it says that PFOA plus PFOS is greater than the health advisory level, We are going to recommend seeking an alternate water supply and or offering a reverse osmosis system. If there are no data available, we would need to have data to make any kind of recommendation. It would have to answer this to work towards there. What's the next slide, Sue? Okay, so I wanted to point out on this map, and while I'm on this map too, I will also talk about the on-base sampling that Bob talked about with the hydrants and whatnot. Okay, so on this map, I want pointing out the areas that fit this part of the decision tree. And that's up on Colbath, because we believe that that is not from the base here, but it may be from a fire that had foam applied for that. Now that we're still checking into that, that could change. It's not a closed book, but right now we are not recommending that people seek an alternate water supply because they have not exceeded that 70 part per trillion. Similarly, along the Loud Drive for this northern area where Bob and his consultants had sampled right after the March meeting, the levels there are extremely low. I mean, they're lower than Hushra levels. They're probably a couple of part per trillion there. And they don't even match, as you remember the pie chart that Bob showed, they don't match anything from the base. So they might just be from household use of that too. And then it doesn't show on the map, but this arrow is pointing towards the school and then the homes that are between the school and the river. And we don't believe that that is a plume coming from the base. It's because the fires that were put out near the school using foam. And we're getting an understanding of that. Currently, they do not exceed the 70 part per trillion. So currently, we are not recommending that they get an alternate water supply. We're continuing to investigate that area. All right, so let me talk a little bit about the sampling that was conducted on the base. As Bob discussed, they found PFCs in the hydrants that were sampled on the base. So they went to a couple of the commercial buildings and some of the outlying buildings too to sample water from the taps. The concentrations for total PFCs there were just a little higher than Hushra. Now, you would think following our decision tree, that it might look like, well, these are being impacted by the plumes at the base because it's right on the base. Not so fast, because we believe that they are cut off from the base because they're on the Hushra system. So is it because of the water that might not have been appropriately flushed from the hydrants? Well, while we're finding out more about that, because of these low levels, they are not hitting the 70 part per trillion. So this evaluation actually would fall on the right side of that decision tree flowchart sheet. So it should not be impacted, it should not be down gradient from plumes at the Air Force Base because they should not be getting to them. So we need to use the 70 part per trillion there. Okay, I'm going to move on, Sue. So I'm going to turn this over in just a second to the local health department, but I can take a few questions now, unless you want to hear what they have to say about the reverse osmosis system program. Any hands for questions? Senator Stamos?
The gentleman first.
Okay, yes, sir. The question is, does the reverse osmosis system remove the PFCs from the drinking water? Our understanding is yes. The system that is being proposed by the water treatment company that's been tagged by the local health department to do this work is one that was tested in a group by the Minnesota Department of Health. Minnesota's been dealing with PFC contamination longer than Michigan has, and because 3M, a major manufacturer of PFCs, is in Minnesota. So Minnesota Department of Health conducted a study on several water treatment systems and found reverse osmosis systems that have activated carbon within their whole unit do a very good job of removing that. So we have information from a study done by Minnesota. We also have information from several wells in the area. People let us know, oh, well, I've got an RO system already. So we said, well, we gotta test the before and after. And these RO systems that people are using, and they might not be the same brand, but that they also fall on the list of ones that Minnesota tested. Are those samples that were taken before and after show very good removal, almost non-detect in some cases. So if you can't detect them, that tells me it's doing a really good job. Did that answer your question sufficiently? Okay. Yes, sir. So the question was, the buildings that were tested on the base, which taps, and were they similar across the board? There was a system. Can you back up one slide, please? Okay, so the ones that I can remember as far as being sampled, I think there were eight areas. Eight?
There was eight.
Eight, thank you, Dale. There were eight buildings that were sampled. One was the Airport Authority office, one was the health center, one was the museum, the community center. Then I believe there was a sample taken up here, building 5109, I think. There was a sample also taken out here, and the Mission Drive. The pump and treat there. So drinking water sampled, so it was drinking water, it was from drinking water taps, and they were fairly consistent. I think the highest was, did I say 20 or 30 part per trillion, because that was Mission 20, okay. I just can't remember all these numbers. For total PFCs, there were some results that because it's such low levels, the lab had difficulty calibrating its equipment to such low levels. And when that happens, they can actually report back higher levels that are actually there. So we did some retesting of some drinking water samples that were showing something like that. And when we told the lab, hey, clean up your act, do a better job on the calibration here, the results came back and lo and behold, they were lower. So basically what we are seeing here, fairly consistent across the board. Nothing like this, right around between Hushra and a little bit more. So they are definitely lower than 70. How about one more question and then I'm gonna turn it over to Denise. Yes, sir.
Can you go back one more slide, I believe it is? No, one more. There you go.
Okay.
So are you saying this evening that all of the homes that are now in those yellow surrounded areas are now, instead of the 27 families that had received a notice, have now been given notice tonight that they are eligible for the reverse osmosis and are considered contaminated?
Yes, let me walk through that. So this is the data are not necessary. We are going to consider them contaminated. Some of them we already have data for. Some of them have been sampled more recently and we have not gotten the data for, but we expect them to be contaminated at some time. So you are getting notice of that decision tonight, but that decision is not based on your specific data. And then here, these people, I have reached out to these people, and I think I've gotten two out of three of them for the ones who have been sampled. And I believe that I have spoken with at least one of the two wells that have been sampled in this area, the property owners for those.
And that equals approximately 100 new homes?
This will be, no.
Not on public water?
No. This area, I believe we are thinking about 50 private wells, and there is the mobile home park that is right about here. So that would be, I'm thinking we are close to 20 units in that, or maybe less for the mobile home park. 22 that are in there, did somebody say?
Chris, I think we can help you out with this question.
Okay, can you come up to the mic over here, Bob, please?
Actually, we need to get help.
To the mic.
That was turned off? Yeah.
Oh.
All right. Well, we've been out sampling these areas, and let me draw.
So the
microphone.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Thank you.
All right. There's a lot of complicated. What's that?
The microphone.
Can you take it off there, maybe?
Maybe. All right. That helps. Okay. All right, so your question, this area we know is something like 50 to 60 homes, right, Dave? Something like that. And then over here, Dale, how many on Oak Street?
On Oak Street, I think we sampled about a dozen.
Right. Oh, you're up to a dozen?
Plus or minus.
Yeah, so okay. We're expecting those to come back as impacted. Over here, we did six wells or seven, maybe more. How many did we end up with?
I think we did six there that we sampled. PCE and
PFCs. Right.
We don't have the PFC results back yet.
Yeah, we have data from two of those wells that are contaminated with PFCs. The other four or five, whatever it is, those we haven't got the results back yet. So we'll see if there's more in that area that are going to need to be replaced. And then if all those are impacted, we're obviously going to keep moving out till we bound that issue. Then we also went up right in this area and have sampled some more wells in that area. Now, on this side of the lake, it is just packed with cottages, just as close together as you can. And so we've counted some like 250 cottages all along there. I'm expecting this right here is probably a limited situation, but I'm not guaranteeing anything because every time I think I know what's going on, I find out I don't. But anyway, we think that's going to be limited on how big or how wide those plumes are. But if they aren't, we're going to find out. So for the moment, we're, what does that make? That's maybe 80 wells right now that we're pretty sure are impacted, and then we'll move from there.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Chris? Paul.
When you talk about results based for those two circles,
yes.
You're talking about that being just if they're above background, not above the 70?
Correct. For this slide, this is, oh yes, I'm sorry about that. The question was, for these two wells, are we basing it that it's above background, in other words, that it's a yes, no, or that it's 70? This is on the left side of that decision tree, and that is a yes, no. They're above, they're essentially above background. And that it's obviously from Wirt Smith Air Force Base fingerprint plume. I'm going to turn this over to Denise right now and the vendor that they have contracted with so that they can discuss a little bit about the process. But I will be here for questions afterwards as well.
Terry, why don't you come up and get microphone put on? And I'll do my comments right here. I think I want to keep it brief, but I want to address your experience. Life interrupted. That means a knock on your door, a letter in your mail, or a phone call changed your perception of the safe drinking water you had in your home. And from that moment, Now you have questions. What does that mean for you, your family, your property, your businesses? And as a health officer, I solve problems every single day. And my philosophy is to get the helpers around the table to solve the problem. So you're in limbo. I'm so grateful for the experts and the advocates that have been working hard the last 2.5 months to address this situation. This is a precautionary situation. We're not in the red zone, except for one house that I have heard. But that doesn't mean that we should rest on our laurels or pretend there's not a situation to address, because our report card to our children and our grandchildren is a decade out. And I'm committed to addressing the issues and getting the helpers here. Michigan Department of Health and Human Services, Sue Moran's team, exemplary communication and action team. The DEQ with testing, I can't tell you more dedicated people expanding the testing, providing us with more information. Christina Bush is taking calls on a daily basis, and your local health department as well has been working on a daily basis for you. But you're in limbo, and it's an unacceptable situation, so we have to keep the helpers moving, and we have to know what's going on, because we're very thankful for the township with the municipal action point. The Senator Stamos's advocacy legislatively and with finding funding is absolutely key. So we have $100,000 dedicated to a more seamless water supply for your homes. And I'm not an expert on the filtration system. We found a local vendor, decades of experience in filtration systems, so that's more than just a plumbing expertise. Terry Edwards out of West Branch has been updating me on reverse osmosis filtration systems, as well as the water cooler option and what that would mean. So we prepared for those homeowners and families impacted by the health advisory, and then those with the decision tree that Christina's explaining, information so you can make an informed decision. With that information, you'll make your selection, and Terry will come out to your home and provide you information. I am very understanding that future maintenance and costs of filter changes, or when $1,000 on the water cooler expires and is used up, what next? I don't make promises I can't deliver, so I can't tell you what that next step is. I will tell you we're going to be here with you to make sure you have more information as to what that next step is for you. There is short-term problem solving. That's what filtration and the water cooler, whatever you want to choose, is about. It's about getting you out of limbo and getting you back into a routine for your home or your cabins. That is the goal. The municipal water hookup is ultimately a longer-term solution, and there's a lot of work going on, both at the township with grant writing, both with the state and legislatively, as to what we can do to address that. So those are my comments. You know you can reach out to me as your health officer or any of the staff. If you have questions tomorrow, you're our neighbors. We're here for you. With that, I would like Terry to update you on the filtration system and whatever questions you have on that, so you can make your informed decision. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Terry Edwards, and I'm the local Culligan man. Denise contacted me from the health department and asked if we could help with the situation you have here, and reverse osmosis is one of the options that I'm offering tonight. The object here is to get the PFCs down below 1, even though they want to go, 70. As still, we're going to go way below that. Reverse osmosis is a very good system. It it'll produce about, 1,000 gallons before you need to change the filters on it. And that's about once a year. You use it for the cooking and making coffee and orange juice and ice and stuff of that nature. Also, I have another option of bottled water. Some people don't trust, filtration systems. And so I have 5-gallon bottled water that I could offer. So you have both options on the table. And if anybody has any questions, I'd be more happy to answer them. Go ahead. The machine will definitely...
Terry, I'm going to repeat the question. So the question is on the filters, when do they clog up or wear out, what the next step is for that?
How do you know when to replace?
On an average, it's once a year. You won't use over 1,000 gallons. We set it pretty high, but that's what everybody uses as a base for the changing of the filters. And the machine what we're offering here with our reverse osmosis, we're even going one step further and putting on a total defense filter, which takes out PFCs too. So we're going one beyond what a normal RO system would do and putting on the total defense system, which eliminates everything out of the water. So if that answers your question. Yes, ma'am.
The question is the filter location in the sink or is it in the bathroom and in other parts of the house?
We're contracted to put one faucet at your sink. We're going to, whatever it takes to drill a hole, we're going to put another faucet there strictly for the drinking part. You can put it in other locations. It's just but we're only contracted to do one thing for here tonight. So you can expand it if you'd like, though. Yes, ma'am.
I have a few questions, kind of. The last time we were here, I don't remember who was talking about it or who joined the slide, but they talked about a filtration system, and they showed pictures of them, and he kind of showed a couple different ones, and he said how one of them had a smaller cylinder. He said it was not good enough to do it. Then he showed another one with a larger canister, and he said this is what we would end up needing to take care of these PFCs. Then the picture I know that we've gotten like on a little sheet or paper seemed to be the smaller ones. Now I'm kind of confused. Is that large enough and good enough from the last meeting that we had here versus what I've seen?
Okay, hold up, Terry.
Okay.
The observation is at the last meeting, the resident felt there was pictures of different size filters. And now there's some confusion because there was a really big filter used. And now looking at the size of Terry's filters, she wants some clarification about the efficacy of this filter.
I wasn't here for the last meeting, but charcoal filters are, you need more bed depth on a charcoal filter. That's why you would have to have a much bigger filter to take out more PFCs. But the best way to take out PFCs is still reverse osmosis, bar none.
But the size wouldn't, because I still have a couple questions about it. Because he said that's what he was talking about, is the size needed to be bigger. And the ones that I've seen in the picture that he said probably wouldn't be good enough with the smaller cylinders.
I do have the units in the back room back over there.
And then he said, too, that it's hard to tell with them when they're full. And if they are full, that you will actually get more out of it than you would if you were just drinking it straight after that, if it filled up and you didn't realize. Because you couldn't tell when they were full of the PFC.
The comment is that the filters, if they were to clog up with PFCs, they would be saturated. And the concern is if maintenance was not kept up timely, according to the expert with the filtration, could there be more exposure to the PFCs that were clogging in the filter?
And the answer to that question would be on carbon filtration, yes, you would have that problem because You either have to change the cartridge or you'd have to back flush it to wash it all away. Well, that's why reverse osmosis is the best way to handle the problem, is because it rejects the water to drain versus, you know, that one there, you don't have a clue on how often it needs to be changed because it doesn't have a filter rating as how many gallons it'll do. Where reverse osmosis, it'll takes it all, doesn't matter what comes at it.
Okay, can I ask one more? Because this is part of my question. Researching some stuff, and I know like Minnesota would be one place, but I know there's a few different places that had issues with PFCs and stuff. They were talking about filtration systems and the research that they have done on using them and what to get and like maybe the best results, you know, and steps to do it. They talked about one that they abbreviated as GAC.
Yeah, GAC, yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And it was a...
That's a carbon filtration.
Yes, it's a granulated one. That was their first choice, and then the reverse osmosis would be a second backup with it or a second choice.
The resident has identified a GAC system from looking at other areas in the country that have used a filter system. So she wants to know if that was their recommendation as first over reverse osmosis.
Well, on my reverse osmosis, it has a particulate filter, then it has a GAC filter, and then it goes through the reverse osmosis, and then it goes through a total defense system, and then it has a polishing filter before it hits the which is another carbon filter. So we got you covered.
I think one of the other comments that had come up is if I choose the filtration system, is there a chance, not that we would test everyone, but where the DEQ could come back and do a quality control test on that water, and then can we share that if this household was at 20, are we down to below 1? So I have put that on my question list, because when you come back and share your concerns, I have it on a list. So that may help with the user confidence when we have some data to back that up.
Go ahead, sir.
No, I don't want you leaving here being totally relaxed, so I have a two-pronged problem. Number one would be, what would the approximate cost be of installation of a basic reverse osmosis system? And secondly, what would the yearly cost for maintenance be?
The question is regarding the cost of a reverse osmosis system in general, the estimate, and then what's the estimated cost of annual maintenance?
To your question, every situation is different because every house is not set up the same way. Yep. And so it can range. The state is going to pay for the reverse osmosis roughly about $900 for it to be installed. And the yearly maintenance on something like that would be about $220 to replace those filters. I'm used to it.
With the process, Terry will come out to your home and will provide an estimate back to me, because there is going to be some particular differences. Could be water pressure, it could be the amount of burping tanks you need. So I'm going to let him do the estimate, and then he needs to give that to me. And if that's what we need to do for that resident, I'll approve it, and then he'll come back out for an installation date.
And what she just was talking about, I was talking with her, it says, you know, some people have families and they use a lot more water, because the reverse osmosis, you know, we have the burp tank, that's where the water is being stored, and it's about 3.5 gallons in that burp tank. Well, some families use a lot more than that, so we can, you know, the machine will make more water than that, but the storage is only 3.5 gallons, so we could add another tank, and so you'd have 7 gallons. You know, so there's lots of options to go, depending on your situation. That's what we're going to deal with. That's why I like to come out and check your house and see what's going on. Yes, ma'am.
A lot of us are snowbirds and we're gone for 6 months. The filters you stayed on for a year. If we go away for 6 months during the winter, is it going to freeze the filter? Are you going to use it in the bath? Or
you have to.
Our resident has inquired about the snowbird. They're here seasonally, and so when they leave, there's going to be downtime. So what does that mean for maintenance and filtration?
You have to keep the reverse osmosis in a heated area. You can't let it freeze, bar none.
Okay.
If it freezes, it'll bust and break anyway.
Can it be winterized?
Can it be winterized? No.
It can be, partially can be winterized, but the actual module has to be left in water. Once it's out of its, there's a formaldehyde is actually in there holding it, and that we have a process where we get all rid of that out. But once the module gets wet, we got to keep it wet in a warm area so it can't freeze. You can winterize it all you want, but you'd still end up replacing that filter if you didn't do it correctly.
Let's do one more question, and then we'll go on with more presentations, and of course we'll have final questions and answers too. Any last question? Yes.
With the water bottle cooler.
Yep.
The resident is saying if they went with the option of the water cooler system and they do monthly delivers and we capped it out at 1,000 to make it equivalent to that of the filter system, what happens after that? Well, Terry would like to keep selling you water. I would like to keep telling you that there's endless buckets of money, but there is not. I can only tell you that we are going to continue to look for funding. And there is also a long-term strategy of municipal water hookups that we're waiting for more information to come in on that. You know, when you're a fiduciary, that means the health department, your local health department, has a responsibility of accounting for the funds in a responsible manner. And we had a lot of families, and I can tell you it just grew tonight by a few more families. And I need to make sure every family has a chance to pick the filter system or the bottled water system, and that we can meet those needs. But there's going to be ongoing advocacy to look for additional funding and diverse funders, other funders to come through as well. So that's what I have, I think, for Terry, because we need to keep moving, and then we'll come back to more questions. I will be staying. So will Terry.
Our next speaker is David Strange, representing the Air Force.
Excuse me, Denise. Hi, Air. Can you hear me?
Yep.
And thank you, Sue. I don't have a lot. In fact, I haven't prepared anything new for tonight. An awful lot of what the Air Force has been doing, you've already heard from, particularly from Bob Delaney. We did do, as Bob told you, a fairly detailed record search. He showed you a figure, a whole series of sites, which the first thing we need to do is decide if there have been any spills in those sites. And that's critical to eventually figuring out where the plumes are and determining if there are human health exposures and what will be our long-term management strategies. So that was our next focus. When we were here in March, we reported that we had the plan in place. We'd coordinated with DEQ where we were going to go. All of that data was gathered in the month of May and the first week of June, which seems like a long time ago tonight. but that work is done. The other piece of our spring work is there were numerous seasonal residents who had identified wells in the areas that we were sampling, who we have revisited. There are actually still six folks that haven't returned to town yet, and we're working with them to get them scheduled to resample their wells also. And when we do that, Bob and his team come with us and they split samples, which then they put into their database and also essentially provide a back check on the data that we do. That data is starting to pour in. In fact, my contractor, I've lost track of Beth's in the back there. She told me this morning that the last piece of data from our Springfield effort actually arrived in their shop late Friday. We'll be sitting down, putting that together. It'll start to really bring into focus some of these pictures that Bob was showing to you and help us do the maps. It'll tell us It'll begin to give us a vision as to where the plumes are in terms of depth, which is important. It'll certainly help us get the footprint of the plumes. And it will also identify a series of new questions, some of which we'll be able to answer. We have some work programmed for this fall, but we're envisioning a program that's at least as big for the 2017 program, which is essentially what we view as a remedial investigation level. So we're going to start taking this significant focus that we got this year, and hopefully by the end of next year, we will have begun to assemble what we like to call a more refined conceptual model. That's basically geek speak for beginning to figure out what's going on in greater detail. So we will continue to work closely with the DEQ on that. It's going to focus us on our goals, which are understand where these plumes originate and what kind of exposures are happening. And then we'll continue to work with both DEQ and DHS to work with that data and then move forward on what will at some point become a remedial solution. In some cases, we may move out like we did at the fire training area and put some we call interim solutions in. As I reported in March at the fire training area, we identified that plume several years ago and actually in April of 2015 turned on a system that is designed to intercept that plume before it goes in the marsh. If we see additional exposures, we'll be working, and we do anticipate that there will be some opportunities to do similar work in the very near future, perhaps as soon as 2017. And that's basically where we are right now. We'll be taking this year's data, working, it gives me a great excuse to come to Oscoda, so in probably the August timeframe, we'll be sitting down with Bob's team, looking at the data. It'll build some questions. By this fall, we'll be working on the strategy for what's the appropriate work to do next year. And we'll be right back out next spring gathering data to bring this into better focus. And that's basically what I had for the day. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is it the Air Force's position that the DHHS has overstepped and that there is no personal risk to the individuals currently that are under 70 parts per trillion?
No. The Air Force's position is, the question is it the Air Force's position the DHS has overstepped with their recommendations? And the answer is no. We're not in the local health business. We're in the cleanup business. We have some parameters that we're confined by based on what the standards are. But I think that what I see is the team really coalescing around a better and better developed regulatory system, and I certainly see us moving towards a long-term solution that works for all of us.
What is a long-term solution for the Air Force base, and how long-term is it?
Long-term solution is a remedy that is protective of human health and the environment.
And the
question was, what is a long-term solution?
And how long for your long-term solution?
Oh. We anticipate once we complete this remedial investigation, the question is how long is it before we get to a long-term solution? You really need to complete what we call the delineation of the nature and extent, which means we need to know where what the concentrations are, where they're moving, and then that would allow us to do impact. We won't have that complete picture before the end of the 2017 summer. And at that point, it should start to point us toward what are the remedies that need to be in place to be protective.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Oh, many. I'll start here. Yeah.
Would that assist in funding if it takes 2-3 years? If we do go to the city water, would the Air Force provide funding? Or once we run out of this $1,000 cap, does the Air Force step in and help civilians?
We're currently restricted, and this is what we reported in March.
Repeat the question, please.
Well, I'm sorry. The question is...
Do you want me to do that? Go ahead.
I'm sorry. The question was, does the Air Force have funding if a year from now the DHS program that Denise described it would replace filters and that sort of thing forgive me for paraphrasing a little bit. And the answer is we'll have to look at individual exposures. Right now, we are constrained by the federal guidelines, which are the 70 PPT numbers that Chris talked about earlier. So we don't have the ability to step beyond that. Yes?
Those of us that have had our wells tested, how soon will they be retested to see if the numbers are different?
We don't. The question was, for those folks who have had their wells tested, when would they be retested to see if they're different? Right now, we don't have a program in place that would be necessarily retesting wells until we think we've done something that would have affected, would have changed the condition. So if we put a remedial system in upgradient that we think should start to clean up or reduce the concentrations, I can see an opportunity down the road to start assessing that. But for now, we've got a pretty good snapshot of what's in your wells. These systems have been out there for a long time, so we're focusing on understanding where they're coming from and what would be the right thing to do to manage those.
What I'm looking at is, okay, what if my well is like borderline? My number is 69, and you're saying it's 70 is the cutoff. I'm not going to qualify. But what if in 3 or 4 months something changes with the plume and my numbers go up? When I'm at a borderline number, what happens?
The question was, what if I'm right at the boundary? I'm at 69 instead of a 70, and I didn't qualify. We don't have any of those scenarios. In fact, we've either been way over or way under the 70 number. It would be a very different scenario if you were sitting at 69. We would all be working together, too, and we probably wouldn't be cutting the line that close. Paul?
Can you point out that you said the Air Force is going to meet the federal standard? Can you talk just a little bit about the new federal standard versus the new state standard? Because they came up with a new state standard. Isn't the state standard even higher than what the federal standard is?
I wish I had pored over that, but we did talk this morning. The question was, how does the new federal standard work compared to some proposed cleanup numbers that the DEQ has actually in the mill right now? If I recall the numbers correctly, the federal number is actually lower than the targets that were in the RRD's cleanup proposal. But for all practical purposes, from where I sit, they look very similar. So I don't think they're going to drive the program, but they are going to affect the targets. And our old rule of thumb is the most stringent of federal or state is where we go. Question in the back.
Yeah, I was one of the people that got a letter saying don't drink the water anymore. And I'm wondering how long can we go with what we've got, even though we do get an RO system or something, but we water our garden. Does it affect our vegetables?
I'm looking at Chris, who's done a little more work with than. The question where there was kind of twofold question there. The first one is if we're using this water for like watering our vegetable gardens, does it affect us? Does it affect us in the showers or other non-drinking uses, if I paraphrase a little bit?
Okay, I'm going to address those real quick, and then if there's questions that can go back to the Air Force, turn that over. As far as watering your gardens, Minnesota. A lot of research there, and they have done research on gardens, vegetable gardens, people's own gardens, that were watered with PFC containing water. Very small amount of PFC getting in there and into the produce, hardly anything, and would not be expected to be any kind of impact to public health. As far as using this water to wash, or to bathe in, no problem. We do not expect any kind of skin contact to be an issue. It's basically what I'm telling people, anything that goes down the hatch, that's what we're concerned about.
Anything else?
Could I just add that at the last meeting we received several pages of questions from Van Etten Lake residents. And we have responded to those questions. DHHS, DEQ, Air Force, Escoda Township, and District Health Department number two. Some of those issues are addressed in that document, and we do have copies of those available with all the handouts on the table. Also, we indicate we have a response in that document to let you know that playing in the water is fine. So swimming in Vanetten Lake, boating, not an issue. Don't worry about the skin contact. It's swallowing it that's the issue.
All right.
All right, let's move on. And we will have lots of time for questions and answers after all of our speakers have completed their presentations. Next up, we have Senator Jim Stamas, please. Do you prefer the lapel mic or?
Sure.
All right, set. Does it work for you? Works for you? All right. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak tonight. Since March, I've taken a very aggressive approach, quite honestly, with DHHS. I think DEQ has did a very nice job in continuing to look at and use the systems and priorities that they have put in place. DHHS has worked with me, and I want to give the directors of both DEQ and DHHS a shout out, along with their leadership. They've done a very nice job keeping in touch with me, continuing to respond. It isn't as fast as I think you would like. However, in government times, we are actually moving very, very quickly. And so, which makes me want to just become bald, so I pull my hair less. But we are moving very quickly, and so I've taken a multiple approach in what we're seeing tonight. And so the first thing that we went back and said was that we've now told 24 residents they had received a letter saying you cannot drink or cook with your water, and my response was then, what are we doing for the residents? And they're like, well, we told them not to drink or cook with the water. And I'm like, but you have to provide alternatives. And so that is where we started the conversation in the short term. Denise has did a wonderful job arranging for additional water supplies that the families have been allowed to have access to, and the locals, I think the local grocery store provided some of the bucket or carrying opportunities along with, I think, Walmart, was it? And so I want to give them a shout out and say thank you for their cooperation. And I can't tell you the amount of time that both Denise and the township within the community is putting into this with the engineering, with looking at the long-term solutions. I'm extremely pleased with the township, and I appreciate all of their efforts in moving forward and providing information as soon as it's asked. And so I want to give a shout out to the townships as well. So again, multiple approaches. First is short term, whether it's the reverse osmosis, it's bottled water. We're trying to find a short term solution for you, which is at least a sustainable period until, quite honestly, the long term solution to me and to anybody that we've talked to is getting on one of the municipality systems. And so we are looking at that. We've taken multiple approaches. My first is to ask the Air Force to do it, but they're not quite ready to do that. And so I have introduced a bill, Senate Bill 950, which would require the federal government or the military services. I can't specify the Air Force or Department of Defense because then I'm narrowing the scope. But in general terms, it's basically asking the Air Force to provide such if the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services has determined that a water source is not of suitable drinking water. And so we're moving forward with that. I'm hoping to have a hearing. I was hoping to get it before we broke for break. I was not able to get that. So my request now is into the chair to get it taken up in September. I may even try to talk him into talk Senator Casperson into trying to do it even over the summer. So I'd like to move forward with that so that in September the Senate could actually at least take it up, get it over the House of Representatives, and continue to move forward with it. Air Force is not quite in agreement, and neither are all of the other entities, to be fair to the Air Force. We're still working on it, but it has been turned in, and that's what happens with a bill, is the discussion begins. How do you word it? How do you do it? I'm not waiting for the Air Force, quite honestly, to step up. We know that that's probably after 2017 at this point. And so the next alternative was to find the short-term solution and the long-term. And we've taken a multiple approach. We've gotten funding. I've secured basically approximately $1 million within the last budget that was just approved by us through the Department of Health and Human Services. Number one, to help pay for some of the filters, or at least provide a grant to the locals that's being reimbursed, is I think how I have to properly say that. And so on top of that, part of the money, my hope was to work with DEQ in getting the monitoring wells in place so that we can start watching and observing and learning more of where that's going. Part of our challenge, quite honestly, is that I'm somewhat threading the needle in the state of Michigan because, number one, we're not over the 70 parts. We are not the only community in the state that has PFCs. There are other communities that have not received, quite honestly, from the Department of Health and Human Services, a letter saying, don't drink the water. Part of the largest part of the reason that they have not received that is because they do have monitoring wells in place to be able to tell where the PFOs and the PFAS are going. And so, but without those in place, they felt that it was necessary to step up and give the public warning. And I appreciate that they're putting public safety up front. The challenge is that it doesn't meet any of the current standards for anybody to give you any help. So they've sort of said, don't drink the water, thank you, have a good day. They're helping. And part of me is frustrated with that, but on the other side, they have truly stepped up. They are working with us. They have worked to find some of the short and long-term solutions. And so part of me is like, why are we doing it if it hasn't met that standard? But the other part says, you know, thank you for at least following through with the discussions that we have. The next part of that is finding the long-term solution, which is the, the municipal water. I've taken two approaches. Number one is part of the $1 million will be used for the installation of the water system as we did it. But we've also reached out, and myself and Congressman Kildee have reached out to the Department of Agriculture, who does actually have a rural development office that does have emergency water sources available. We have, with the township's assistance and Denise and others and the DHHS and DEQ, are all working together to actually get a grant that would pay $30,000 towards the engineering and then up to, I think, $500,000 towards the municipal water system, along with the dollars I've been able to put within the DHHS budget. I believe we can get a long-term water solution in a timely manner, which is why the filters are at about a year. The water supply hopefully lasts about a year. I will look at it as the progress goes and see if I can't get enough, you know. We have to see where the next system is, but whether it's trying to find additional funding for new filters and or extension of the bottled water, we can look at that as time goes forward. But working on multiple fronts, trying to find and get the solution so that you have the peace of mind for you and your children, that you're drinking from a safe water system, you can cook with it, and continue on with our lives. I think Oscoda has a lot of awesome things going for us with economic development, with Coletta, with Alpena Community College now coming in. There's a lot of exciting things that are going on here that we want to take advantage of. And making sure that we have a safe water system certainly has to be part of that priority. And so that's where we're at. And so I do want to make sure to give a shout out also to Senator Peterson and Stabenow. We're also on the phone call today with Department of Agriculture So they are monitoring the situation. And I think that's it at this moment. I'm happy to take a few questions or wait till we get done. Yes, sir.
Okay. In regards to having being able to hook up to municipal water system, what kind of time frame are you talking about? Can, as homeowners, can we go ahead and pay to have it done and then be reimbursed at a later date, or do we have to wait for you and the bill to say, okay, now you can do it?
Right. So number one, we're not waiting for the bill. The bill is to ask the Air Force to actually reimburse us for it as we go forward. I'm not waiting for the Air Force. And so
What's the time frame then? The
bill is, but for the time frame, that's what we're trying to work with and look at. If we can get the information to the Department of Agriculture and get the loan approved, we're hoping to know more on that timeline next week. But the discussion was very, very positive this week. Whether and or how the municipal system is, that's the part we're still working on. That's why I've pushed very hard to do the filters and or the bottled water so that we have the peace of mind now while we're still getting the other parts in place. My hope is, quite honestly, that by the middle of next, you know, by the middle of next summer, you have a water, municipal water system in front of your home that is able to hook on to. How the expenses work, I don't know that. I mean, a lot of times in a municipal water system, there's a hookup fee. There's also the cost of running it to the house. None of that has been worked out yet. We're trying to work that out and talk about it. It sort of depends on the dollars, how much the engineering says that it's going to cost. We're trying to make sure we have all of those dollars and get it as inexpensive to anybody that needs it as possible. But I don't have those answers. I hope within a couple months we'll be back here and I can tell you exactly on the long-term solution, but tonight I can't promise something until I've got it. And so I can tell you what I'm trying to do, I can tell you where we're at with it, but I can't promise you something until they move forward with it. Other than,
are you saying that we should not go ahead and have it done on our own and pay for it and hope for reimbursement? Or
I'm saying that would be a decision you would have to make on yourself about the guarantee. Would I ask that they would put forward the same reimbursement? I would be happy to ask that. But until I have the numbers of where and how those dollars are being spent, I can't promise you that. And so, and I wouldn't want to stand here and tell you that. But would I say, I think that if we're doing this for one group, then those that took the initiative, yes. I think that, honestly, if you have it in front of you, I guess the question to me would be, instead of the reverse osmosis and or the water, can the $1,000 at least be applied? I'm happy to ask that question and see if we can't get the answer. But tonight, standing in front of you, I can't tell you that. So
I appreciate everything you've done so far.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Am I correct in assuming when you say connecting to the municipal system, you are referring to the area near the air base and not all the way up Loud Drive? Because if you end up with that, you may end up with a civil war.
That is what we're trying to look at is. And the question is, are we looking at both sides of the lake and or the areas that are being looked at and investigated, whether the municipal water would be provided to both sides and or.
Correct.
And so I don't have the answer. At this point, we're looking at how much of anybody that is affected and how do we get a municipal water to them. And so whether, and part of it will be as the information of the investigation continues forward, where we find what they consider contamination is going to affect, and if I will continue to look for and provide the long-term solution for all residents that are affected. But where and where it's not, we're still working on that, and I don't have specifically a long term of where exactly the water is going yet. All right. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. And thanks for the turnout tonight.
Our speakers have completed their presentations. It's time for that open question and answer session. So any questions that you have that weren't answered already, please feel free to let us know. Yes, sir. Yeah, we'll have Chris come up to the microphone. The question is about the accumulation in the body and how long before you would reach a point where it's harmful.
Okay, so about how long can you expect this to build up in your body before something happens? It's really not something that can be predicted. We kind of have to do a whole... a larger view approach, and we can't really individualize them. So there are things to consider in that some of the health effects that we might be concerned about for the PFOA, the PFOA, that was, there was a very large scale human study down in West Ohio and West Virginia where DuPont released PFCs to the Ohio River. The Ohio River was used as a drinking water source. The main PFC in that situation was PFOA, PFOA. There were some probable links found between the exposure people had there in their drinking water to certain health outcomes. Those health outcomes included thyroid disorders, liver, I believe increased liver enzymes, high cholesterol, pregnancy-induced hypertension, such as preeclampsia, and then cancer of the kidney or cancer of the testicles. And I'm trying to think, was there anything else that comes to mind? Oh, yes. Thank you, Bob. Ulcerative colitis was another one that they felt was showing up more in people who were drinking that water, essentially. With PFOS, that is more seen from people in Minnesota who worked at the factories, and there are concerns about that as far as what are some of the impacts it could have to children or to adults. There might be behavioral issues. There might be a reduced response to vaccination, so it might be something to do with the immune system. So we have concerns about that. There's not as large-scale studies for PFOS as there is for PFOA as far as humans who have been studied, human groups or human communities, essentially. So there have also been studies in people who have been tracked by a study at the CDC every about 5 years or so, 3 to 5 years, the CDC goes out and takes blood samples of a representative population that represents the U.S. population. So they select these people and track the amount of chemicals or in some cases, normal parameters of blood. So they have tracked PFCs in people's blood, and they are finding that in general, because of the decrease and the phase out of the manufacture and use of these chemicals, that they have decreased in the general population. We're not talking about populations such as when I was talking about the C8 study, Ohio, West Virginia, the PFOA, and the Ohio River. So there have been researchers who have looked at those populations, those data for people who are being tracked by the CDC, and compared it to what kind of health outcomes they are seeing in those people compared to people with lower levels, or what kind of commonalities are they seeing with some of those results? And they are able to track some of that as far as, again, the cholesterol issue in both adults and children, thyroid issues that are showing up. But predicting when or even if something would happen to you, this is not a slam dunk. I'm not going to tell you right now you are going to get sick because of this. We have the concern that there could be a health impact. So that's why we're taking this protective approach. And I want to, Bob's got his hand raised, so he probably wants to say something to that.
Just to help you understand why this is, you can't easily answer that question, is everybody's familiar with smokers. And my dad smoked 2 packs a day for almost all his life, never got cancer, never got emphysema. It was because of his genetics. So these are the same type of thing. You know, one person smokes a little bit, they get cancer, lung cancer. Another one smokes like a chimney and never gets cancer. So that's why Chris can't say, yeah, you will get a problem if you drink that this much for this long. It's just like cigarette smoking, only more complex than that. So.
Yeah, and Bob made that answer a whole lot simpler than I did, and maybe I should have just had him answer that. And I'll stick with the geology questions. Okay.
Yes, Peggy. The question is in regard to the swallow, or the study that was done on the tree swallows and finding PFCs in the swallows and PFCs moving through the food chain.
Yeah, we did look at swallow data. The USGS conducted some research out by the ponds at Clark's Marsh with tree swallows that nested in the area. And the thing about tree swallows is they will eat the aquatic insects. So they'll be swooping down over the tops of those ponds and scooping up the insects flying over them. So they had a very small feeding range, and it was found that these tree swallows had the various tree swallow flocks, if you will, or populations that had been studied around the Great Lakes area by this group, they had the highest concentration of PFCs in their crop contents, so in their stomachs essentially, in their plasma, and also in the egg. So it was definitely moving, getting into their systems and moving through their systems. So the concern from a public health point is that connects to the wildlife is, could it be getting into, we know it's getting into fish, but I do have questions about wild game that are hunted or trapped closer into Clark's Marsh where that contamination is so high. Game that are concentrated in that area. There may be some deer that prefer to stay out in that area, although deer being large animals, they can spread farther, excuse me. The possibility of turkeys in that area, or even smaller game that people may choose to trap and choose to eat. So that is a concern that we have. We do have some information about muskrats that were trapped in the area, and yes, some people do eat muskrats. And there's an indication that there are higher levels of PFCs in those animals than we would expect. So I hope that answers your question somewhat, Peggy. Okay.
I got one for you. You said this would be on channel 190?
Yes, sir.
In about a week, approximately? All right.
So just to play by the rules, the question was, this will be on channel 190 in about a week. And you heard it from JD.
Yes, sir.
I have a question for Mr. Delaney.
Okay. The question is about the turnover of water and how often the water turns over in Van Etten Lake, since it's a large watershed. Does that add any urgency to providing municipal water?
I'll go first to the question of urgency. I don't think that, I mean, I can't off the top of my head see where that would have an impact, because the groundwater movement is the speed is going to be, and it doesn't matter what the watershed does. It's about 2 foot a day, which is really fast in groundwater, but compared to a stream, it's slow. But the turnover in the lake's actually a good thing, in the sense that the fish, they're always getting exposed to fresher water, more dilute plumes. If it sat there longer, it would be more of a problem for the fishermen than anything.
Question is, does it matter if it's deeper water or shallower water?
We haven't looked at the stratification of the plumes, what layers it's at. And you guys that fish know there's the cold water's at the deep, and then you have the turnover and all that. But we don't know if there's a stratification on contamination out in the lake. I tend to doubt it. When you got that fast of flushing in a lake, it tends to, it's not like a lake where the water just sits there, and so then you have that stratification. This lake is moving through pretty fast. But that, again, is, like I say, in the world of geology, you're right most of the time, but you're wrong some of the time. So until we, I'm telling you my best guess estimate is that there's not a problem with stratification, other than you may have certain places where plumes that are really hot are coming out either really deep or really shallow, and so that could have a really localized impact, but it wouldn't be a lake-wide type impact. Me or somebody else?
It's kind of you and probably health department. Maybe.
Okay.
Okay, so the question is that your well has been sampled. Your daughter has come back up to the area with her family next door.
They live here.
They live here.
They
I'm sorry. They weren't here at the time for the previous sampling. They just recently got sampled. But does she have to wait? Well, that's a good question. But first off, the question was, how long would she have to wait? Do you know which area is she in? Is she between the Air Force Base and Van Etten Lake?
She's right next to us, which we're getting. Yes, she's right next door.
So you're on the voucher system? Then chances are she is within that line of the decision tree, that we don't have to wait for data. And I think that she should be speaking to the local health department, to the county health department. So if she goes ahead and speaks with them and just has to verify the address, Denise, I think she might be speaking with some people in back, but just have her call and verify, and that I think will be moved right into place there. Okay, so the question is that she has not received the written notification from the district health department. I would say right now, do not wait for that notification. Call up the health department. Yep, because this is something that we've been working through as far as this decision tree, and where she falls on that decision tree is all the way over to the left side.
She's where the trailer park is, where we live on the road next to it.
Okay, I think I know where you're talking about.
Yeah, so she's
sure, and that was that. I can understand the consternation as far as waiting to be tested and then waiting for the results. And now that we're getting a better understanding of this, we can move to the you don't have to wait to be tested or you don't have to wait for the results if you have been and you're in that certain area. So the because you've been on the voucher system, but they haven't wait, and there's continuing questions about the waiting for the results. I would say don't wait for the results. Indicate to the local health department where the address is, and it should fall into the way that you're describing it to me. I understand it to be that essentially that leftmost on the flow chart. Data are not necessary. You're expected to be impacted. No, have them call the health department, please. Yep, and then I think, because if they wait, I think that you're going to continue feeling this frustration, and she may feel the frustration. And what I really want is for them to have that answer, to know. Okay? All right. I'm going to read some questions off of a card that was handed to me by somebody in the audience, and these questions are directed at both the Air Force and DEQ. And it's several questions, but rather than ask them all at once, I just bit by bit, and then we'll get an answer. Okay, so this is currently the groundwater plume that is, I believe, going through the pump and treats, that's coming up through the pump and treats, or being called the purge water. It is not treated. This is the person's understanding. It's not treated, and then it is discharged or dumped right into Venetian Creek or the Asable River. So regarding the treating of these three purge pump outputs from contaminated groundwater plumes and these current concentrations on base being much higher than that 70 part per trillion, because we're talking about the plumes on base, what control standard or level will the U.S. Air Force install? And I don't know if Bob might already have the answer to that.
Yeah, we talked about that issue today, and the Air Force, I'm going to let Dave also speak to it. Right now, we have a water quality standard of 11 parts per trillion, so it's 11 parts per trillion for surface water. That is based on the fact that these contaminants build up in fish, and so they build up in fish a lot more than they build up in humans, so you can get a lot in the fish. You eat the fish, and you're getting a big exposure. So that 11 parts per trillion is the standard for across our state. Now, the difficulty is that the technologies at that scale, right now, what we're doing, the state is put out a document to the Air Force saying that they need to establish a treatment system that will clean the water down to 20 parts per trillion. That's 9 parts per trillion above the standard, but that was felt what was reasonable to the reasonable level you could get with the technology that exists today. If that technology improves over time, then that number will go down. But for the moment, what's reasonable to attain is 20 parts per trillion, so that's what we're demanding of the Air Force to achieve. And I don't know if you want to save any.
Essentially what Bob said is exactly what went on. The state has identified a best, I think the term is best available technology treatment requirement to us. This is not a snap your fingers and you build the system. So we're going to work with them through the next couple of months to refine the essentially what amounts to would be the permit requirement And it would take a minimum, it would be, if things went perfectly, we would be have that system in place by the end of next year. But I don't know if all those dominoes can fall in place. We're not talking about a simple little screw-on filter here. Yeah.
Dave,
yes.
Just as a little bit of a follow-up. Does the Air Force know how much water is being pumped into the river system unfiltered on a daily basis?
We do, but I don't. The question was: does the Air Force know how much water goes into the receiving waters? And the two receiving waters are Van Anten Creek and the Asable River. And the answer is we do, but I don't have that in my pocket. our pump and treats are pretty significant. It's over 400 gallons a minute.
But yeah. It's treated.
No, well, it's not treated for PFCs.
Yeah, the systems were originally designed for the jet fuel and the chlorinated solvents, so that's why they don't treat for this PFCs. Yeah.
Now that we're aware of it,
right?
And now that the community is concerned about it, and the river is the heart and soul of our area, that is directly affecting what goes in the river. Clearly, is the amount of water coming out of the base. Is there any way to store that water that's not going in the river? Is there a way to put some kind of filtration on that water? Can it be pumped through one of the existing? I mean, I'm stupid about it, so I'm ignorant. Maybe,
right.
Maybe a better word for it. Is there a different way to put that volume of water that's going into the system through any type of filtration? Instead of just opening up the tap and there it goes.
The question is this amount of water is a large amount of water going into the Sable River and the Van Anten Creek, which are very important to the local economy and also to the health of people that are eating the fish. Is there any way that in the interim or immediately that it could be filtered or it could be redirected or stored? The simple answer is no. There's so much water that's being treated that there's just no practical thing you can do. You've got to treat it with the carbon, which takes time to design and build, and then the water volume is too high. And we can't turn off the pumps because they're now protecting the drinking water downstream, and then we'd also release a big chunk of highly contaminated stuff that'd be in the aquifer downgrading of that, so you'd be releasing that. So it's not a good situation.
I didn't say it was an easy solution.
Yeah, right, right. And I'll let Dave, maybe, you know, he's with the Air Force, they come up with all kinds of crazy ideas, so maybe he's got some.
What I was gonna say, what he said, there is no easy temporary fix while we build the permanent fix. The answer is we can't filter the water till we build the filtration system. And certainly shutting off those systems has significant implications that really I think none of us would want. We'd be then allowing plumes that we've got relatively well contained and stable. We would destabilize them and we would lose big pieces of those plumes. And so that would be a mistake. So the best solution is to work together is to aggressively and as quickly as we can to put treatment on, which is not uncommon in the wastewater business.
I'm going to go through the other questions on this card. Some of them have already been addressed in part, but if there's more that David or Bob wants to address towards it. The next question we said, the first question was what control standard or level would the U.S. Air Force install, and Bob addressed that. Then the next question, I need to interpret it a little bit, is there control or should there be control at the point entering storm drains or the outfall to Van Anten Creek and the Asable River? Okay, I just want to be sure that is there anything that you needed to add to that, Bob or David?
Uh, It's right now the discharge from the three main pump and treat systems that we showed that were protecting the downgradient residents. Those are going through storm systems and then they're going out into the surface waters. So those are being tested right now checked. Now there's some other storm sewers that have some lower levels that we have to track down where's that coming from so we can stop it in the future. But so there are some other storm sewers that are problematic at this point in time, but they're not at the same levels.
Okay, and I'm going to cut to the last question that is on here. How does the operational timeline here compared to that at Pease Air Force Base, that's an Air Force Base in New Hampshire, because there the EPA ordered control of the contaminated plume within about 14 months. It went from August 15 to October 2016. And I think David might be the answer person for that.
It's hard to compare them. They really aren't apples and apples. But we had a very specific and understood release at our fire training area that was driving the fishing advisory in 2012. By the end of the summer of 2012, we'd worked together to define the extent of the contamination at that point, and we were already moving forward with the steps that it took to build and contain that system. And in the meantime, we began to develop the remaining systems. The actions at Pease were not dissimilar to what were taken here in terms of they had a very different scenario with a drinking water well. They had a drinking water well that had contaminants that were in the 2,000 parts per trillion range in the well. The day they got the results, they had to turn that well off. That was a 500 GPM of water supply well for the community. So it was turned off immediately. And the follow-on work was very similar to the work that we're doing here. That we're already able to do and are doing cooperatively and certainly are also doing at Pease cooperatively. But a very different scenario. And here we've identified now one well that was above the standard, and we did the same thing. We called the people the day we had the data. But we're also working aggressively to get a complete picture of what's happening on the base and how it impacts people down gradient. Yeah.
Let me say something too. Yeah. Wurtsmith was, I think, really the first base where human receptors were identified, and that was the fishermen and their families, and that was recognized, and essentially the Air Force took it as an emergency, and so they did all kinds of things to get money and to move immediately, and I think this really was the first treatment system ever built by the Air Force to deal with PFCs, so this base got immediate attention. But then with Pease, it was the same type of thing for them. It was an emergency situation. And it goes right to the very highest levels in the Department of Defense at the Secretariat level. They make a decision, we're going to find money and we're going to fix it right now. So those are exceptional cases where, and Wurtsmith has benefited from that type of very aggressive attack. But with the Air Force facing so many different situations, you're going to see that around the country where there's going to be these, we're going to get it done immediately, we're going to find special money, we're going to do whatever. Sort of like Senator Stamos is doing right now with our water situation. He's going out there and he's aggressively trying to find a solution that goes in, that doesn't follow all the normal processes and take all that time because it's considered a serious health issue. In those both situations at Wurtsmith and Pease, it was an emergency. They could, you know, they can move mountains when they consider it an emergency.
Yes, sir.
I guess the concern related to that is
The comment was, with the high volume of water moving through the pump and treat system, it was 635 million gallons of water. Is that what you calculated?
630 million gallons of water.
Moving into the sewer system.
Yeah. Maybe a good time right now to a little background on the nature of these systems and how long they've been operating. All of these systems, and we have three specific pump and treats designed to treat the airfield area at the base. They were installed to contain originally, and Bob mentioned this earlier, petroleum contamination and chlorinated solvents contamination. The Aero Street system has run since the mid-80s, and the Mission Drive and the benzene plant have run since the late 80s. So we're really talking about a status quo that has been out there for a long time. It is a lot of gallons, and if you multiply it times 30 years, the gallons, it's a big number. But it's the status quo, and there's just we don't have a magic wand that can design and install those systems overnight. It's just that simple. We've got to design, and we've got to go through some approval processes, and then we got to build them.
And I'd say, you know, that is a huge amount of water, but when you think about Lake Huron and it's contaminated at 6 parts per trillion, imagine how much water is going through there and how much other contamination there is out there. I mean, this is a big, big problem. You're dealing with it here in a specific site, and this is all ending up in Lake Huron, this water. So you're actually touching on a lot bigger issue that we're trying to look at as a state and as a country right now. So not a great answer for you, but you're touching on something that's really a problem. So I congratulate you on thinking that those big problems, but that's what it is. It's a big problem.
Yes, Peggy. The comment is to consider the effect of PFCs on the eagle population in the area.
Just to touch upon that comment, my husband works for the DEQ Water Resources Division. They track a lot of the eagle nests around here because eagles are fish eaters. And they did look at the information for, I think, the nest that's on Allen Lake. And that's when eagles fledge, I think is when they fledge too, it's considered a success. So that would still be considered successful. Yes, it's gone down by a third from 3 to 2, but certainly something to keep in mind, and that was something that we were interested in, and I believe that there is interest at the Water Resources Division at DEQ to be able to follow information like this, because with eagles, in the past, the issue has been mercury and the other contaminants that are out in the environment, and that's been tracked, and that has helped as far as moving towards cleanup of environmental levels, making sure that not more is getting out there. So it's possible that tracking something like this, what you're suggesting, Peggy, will help as far as setting recommendations so that we're not just protecting public health, we're protecting the rest of the animals out there.
Before I take any more questions, let me ask if anyone had a question on a comment card that you would like us to discuss. Okay, just didn't want to miss those. Are there any further questions? Yes.
My concern is about Hall Island. Has there been any testing regarding the water there as far as contamination? We have a lot of fish that spawn there, and the waterway has basically become stagnant.
The question is regarding Hall Island and whether there has been a determination about whether to do more testing, water testing, or sampling the fish in the area.
I want you up here, Bob. Just to be sure, I am not exactly sure where Hull Island is, so can you tell me? Because I had gotten a question similar to that before and was looking for it on a map.
Basically, Hull Island is right behind the Admiral Station, so it is right where Manhattan Creek meets Osaba River.
Okay, so Hull Island is by where Manhattan Creek comes into the Osaba River. And that's a spawning area for fish. Okay. I don't believe that that has been sampled, although I think that we have some creek water sample. Okay.
So there, you're not asking about groundwater sampling? There aren't any wells in that area, are there? I didn't think there was down there, but I just wanted to make sure. We have sampled Vanette and Creek, but it's inadequate sampling for answering that question. The results have been they have been really low where we've sampled, but we're thinking it could be just the effect of where we sampled as opposed to getting a good profile of the stream. And it just hasn't been brought up as something we really need to focus on, but we'll take that certainly back to the water resources people.
Did we ever sample that one where it goes into the South River? Do you remember if we put the results for it? I thought we sampled
it. The question was, did we sample at that intersection? And River Road, or we sampled at like the canoe livery area? So I'm not sure where that is in relationship. Okay, but again, that was we were doing it from the shore. So, you know, you could be having discharge of groundwater at that location or something else. So, like I say, it was not adequate to answer your question.
I'm going to head out, so unless there's a specific question, I want to thank everybody for being here.
Thank you, Senator Stamos. Additional questions? Going once? Yes, sir.
Chris, at the last meeting, you, in answering an individual's question about not being able to follow what's been going on in the past, and you guys are doing a great job, and I have to applaud you for that, the agencies that have been involved in it. However, their question was citizen and advisory
The question is about formation of a citizens advisory group to help inform the community about activities related to this project, and then also the benefit to the agencies involved of working with a citizens group.
I think that would be an excellent idea. I wish this question had come up earlier when we had 75 or 80 people in here so that everybody could hear it. But I think that that would be an excellent idea for the community to empower itself like that, get a diverse group of people representing all sorts of facets of the community, whether it's realtors, local businesses, parents, the school community, people working in the Chamber of Commerce, the neighboring communities, conservation groups, things like that, to come together to find the commonalities, because while you are diverse, while there are diverse groups here, you're going to find commonalities, you're going to find strength in that number. I'm not saying that you're weak now. You're definitely strong already, but I feel that if community members come together, select a group to represent them and to be kind of their focal point, to say, we want you to find out this, I think that you'll be more part of the process rather than the process happening and you hearing about it. So I really think that that would benefit so many people. And by you, and I don't want to say you because it makes it sound like I'm putting the work on you, but by the community members taking charge like that, you would be helping us as far as making sure that, well, A, that we're on task. You're already doing that, a very good job about that. But also the communications, we can strive to answer the questions that you have in a more timely manner. Right now, we might not hear questions again from a lot of the people who were here tonight or others until the next time we have a public meeting. But if a community group is developed, there would be more communication happening between that group. It would act as a liaison between the community and the agencies are involved, and a lot more conversation going back and forth. Another benefit that I see to this type of group is rumor control. When the water issue started coming out in late February and in March, and we were preparing for that March meeting, we were hearing from the township, well, these are the rumors that are being spread around, and it's just that game of telephone. You start talking with somebody about what you heard somebody else was questioning about, and the way you remember it is not exactly the same, so the story takes on its own little life, and then it gets passed on to somebody else, and then there's a new life in that story. And by the time it gets around to the person who asked the question in the first place, it's a whole new question. And a whole new answer to it, too, probably, according to the person who started the questioning, and the question circles back to them, well, they've got an answer for it, but it might not be correct. We want to make sure that you have information that you can use that can empower you to make the choices you want to make, and also to help keep your families healthy and keep this community healthy and strong and vibrant. Yes, sir.
Can I ask Dave from the Air Force regarding the Resource Restoration Advisory Board in New Hampshire, please, the state, the environmental agency, and the locals requested the Air Force, and in fact, it's my understanding the Air Force reestablished
They did reestablish the Pease Restoration Advisory Board. I'm not exactly familiar with the mechanism, but essentially it's a request from the community to establish a board. The way those boards work is there's an Air Force chair and a community co-chair, and then there are nominations for membership. The goal is to get a fairly broad cross-section and then to do exactly what Chris was talking about, get some dialogue. Well, there's a whole series of items, but one of the principal tools is now you have a board full of individuals who have a relationship with the folks who have the inside information. So if you get a question, you can, and certainly my old board when we had an active board at Loring, it was not uncommon that I looked up and one of the board members came through the door. They had that kind of access, and then they'd have a question and we could talk to them, and it was a helpful tool. The mechanisms for starting them up are out there. I'm personally not familiar with them. Our boards have, as you guys know, the board here hasn't met for years. I think the last time we did it, we had a rod about 7 years ago. They're definitely a tool that's out there if there's broad enough community interest.
And I just want to say from the DEQ's point of view, we would be really supportive of that kind of interaction. Most of these that I've ever been engaged in have been quite helpful. And just like tonight, I learned about the spawning situation, something I didn't know. I hate to think of myself as a bureaucrat from Lansing, but I'm a bureaucrat from Lansing, even though I'm displaced from the upper part of the state. I just had to go there for a job, but I am not in touch with your community. I don't know the things you know. So we learned about the fires around here up on Colbath by talking to people, and we just found out lots of things by talking to the locals, because you guys know stuff we have no idea. I mean, your local newspaper people have been fantastic for helping us try and understand what's gone on in the past and things like that. So my experiences have always been good with it, and also I agree with the it helps to have an informed public, because especially when you're in something like this where the science is all new, things are changing, we tell you one thing and then the next time we tell you something else, those things need great communication and great trust in order to be able to work effectively together. So the more that kind of interaction, I think the better.
Let me add something. We did actually put out a call at our last meeting in March for interested individuals who would be interested in joining an advisory group, a board, something similar to that. And we had one individual who indicated an interest, and I would suggest to you that that person might be a little lonely. We still have the name, so if this is something that is of interest to you, we could talk after the meeting. Talk to Chris, talk to Bob, talk to David.
I'll add to that too. If it's something that is kind of getting into your mind as far as, what kind of use could that be to me? If you are on Facebook or if you have web access, go to the Testing for Peas Facebook page or their website, and you can get to the website from the Facebook page. It's as one word, Testing for Peas, and peas is spelled like the plural for pea with an E on the end. So I've had actually a few conversations with one of the community organizers from that group, and it's just really impressive to see that the work that they're pulling together, and I see so many benefits, potential benefits in this community. You've got kids who probably want to design things for the web. They could design the web page for this. You've got JD here, who could probably, in his spare time, take kids or adults under his wing to teach them about this broadcast, that the equipment and the skills needed for running something like that. You could learn the ways of conducting meetings. You can learn the ins and outs of the whether it's the legislative process that Senator Stamos was talking about, or whether it's the regulatory process, or finding out more about, is the CDC looking into doing any kind of community studies at these places where AFFF, the firefighting foam, has been released? Or are they looking into former base personnel who worked with these chemicals? Are they going to do any studies for that? By acting as a voice, I mean, you do that when you vote, you do that when you go to township meetings, you do that when you come to these community meetings. By being the voice of a group, you get so much more done.
Any further questions? Going once, going twice, gone. Well, once again, thank you so much for coming to the meeting tonight. And if you were here this afternoon, thank you for coming twice. We really appreciate your time, your questions, your comments. We need to know all of these opinions that you have. And it's good for all of us agencies and for Senator Stamas to hear them as well. So thank you again. I do want to mention that we still have handouts on the table. We have those Q&A documents that will answer some of the questions for you. We have our new fish advisory brochure. So take a look over there. Take things home with you, please. Chris and Bob do have their business cards over there, so feel free to contact them in the future if you have additional questions. And my guess is we'll be back before too much longer. Thank you very much.